It's time for another Dice Tower review with the Chief, Bart Brunsheen.
This is the Chief from the Dice Tower. Today we're going to talk about D-Day Dice. It's a cooperative game. You can play it solo as well. It's a lot of dice rolling. Think of Yahtzee, kind of how you're collecting sets. The same deal, you can roll up to three times, and there's a couple little differences in there. Simulates World War II, getting up off the beaches in Normandy, although it does cover Sword Beach, Utah Beach, Omaha Beach, and a few different little things along the way. So it started off as a print and play game, and then ended up as a very successful Kickstarter game. And I find it light, but enjoyable. But enough of that, let's go ahead and take a closer look. First, let me walk you through some of the components. You're looking at the starter board, Exercise Tiger. It's the one that's used to train you basically on how to play the game. The boards are excellent. Let me see if I can bring this up a little bit better. Oh, there goes my little marker die. You can see you're going to start, this indicates your starting area, but your start clearly is the landing craft have just let you off, and there's sectors that are clearly defined. Some of them are even restricted in your movement in terms of minefields that are coming up. Some of the key things to look at on this, and I'll just show you this little deal and then we'll look at some of the other boards, is if you're playing this map and you're in here, you would get a scout. It's a specialist that you can pick up, or a sharpshooter here. This will tell you how many soldiers you're going to lose when you finally do leave this sector, and how much courage it's going to take you to leave this sector and move on to the other. This shows that you're going to be under machine gun fire and you'll be losing extra guys. You'll have full regular dice, but here you're going to be limited to just 5 die. Your ultimate goal is to continue all the way up and get into the bunker. So you can see you're going to have to get through some minefields. So maybe you're going to want minefield detector specialists, different things. You can see the amount of troops you're going to lose continues to go up. And then when you get into the bunker, it's going to take a lot of courage and you're going to have to be ready to have enough guys to go in there and get it. Gives you some nice little detailed information. Obviously, this is kind of cool. You're looking at some training that happened. The boards are printed on the other side as well. So you can see here's Omaha Beach. Let me bring in a couple other boards, just so you can kind of get a feel for what you're going to be looking at. I know there's a ton of information on there, but it all works really seamlessly as you go about what you're doing. So, and they did a really good job. So you can see here, Point Duhok. This is where the Rangers had to actually scale the cliffs and get up and get at the large bunker with the big guns that were supposed to be inside. Turned out they were telephone poles, but they still went back and did some damage further behind the lines. So enough on that. So here's your map. This is what you're going to be working up on. You've got a nice little die here that just indicates how long you can stay in a certain sector. After you get to like an upkeep phase, whoops, you'll turn this just to indicate what round you're in and when you have to move. And when you get to this phase, you've got to go on that turn. You must move. So this indicates when you can't stay in a certain sector. It's just too hazardous. You can't stay there. You're going to have to move that round. So that is down on the board just to work as a placekeeper. And then here are your, whoops, here are your Yahtzee-style dice. You're going to see the symbols that are on here. You're going to have soldiers, both two and single soldiers. The death head's going to cancel out a die when you roll it. This goes for courage. And these are, sorry, this is your courage to move up, and the stars allow you to recruit little specialists. So when you roll, you simply will roll it. The very first time you roll the die, you must lock down 2 of them, and then you can re-roll the other 4. And when you re-roll, you can at this point decide to re-roll all of them, keep some of them, and then on your very third re-roll, you're forced to keep whatever you've rolled. So the way you keep track of everything is the reverse side of this nice little dial marker here. You're going to have tools. These will be little tool items that you can collect and buy certain vehicles as it has, or special items, wire cutters and such. You're going to track your soldiers on this dial here. So as you have your soldiers die off, you would be subtracting them down. Or as you're rolling and collecting new soldiers, you just keep track of them on this. You've got your courage, and then you've got your little star points that you pick up. One other thing that goes into your rolling is they've got a really handy chart that covers everything that you're rolling here and what it'll give you. Covers item points and what it needs and when you collect tools and the different start off points on the map. And then there's some very interesting things where if you actually roll certain combinations of red, white, and blue, you will get special little things. This was probably, I'm not gonna say difficult, but in my first few games, I had to refer to this repeatedly. I just didn't know kind of what to go for or what I was rolling for. Again, as you play, you'll pick up on that. You can see the player aid's very handy, but you do have a lot of stuff going on considering you're just rolling dice. But this serves its purpose. The board is, you know, it's not like you're doing battle on the board per se. It's there to kind of tell you what struggles you're going to be going through as you move up. And the way you actually survive or what you're doing is to just resource manage your little card here and make sure you've got enough guys and enough equipment, or you picked up enough stars to get enough items, enough valor to move on to the next level. So it's different, it's fresh, and if you don't mind rolling a lot of dice, and even though it's not a lot of reference and referring to charts and such, you'll like this. All right, D-Day Dice, I like it. Now, first of all, I gotta tell you, I'm a huge fan of World War II, so anything that kind of brings in the World War II theme, I generally like it unless it does it in such a poor manner, and then I will flat out hate it. I like this. It's very light. Cooperatively, I don't know. I don't know if I liked it cooperative as much. There's some little cooperative things you can do. If you get certain cards, you can share those abilities or give someone some help or trade some die with another person. But I got to be honest with you, when I play this, I'll probably play it solo. I don't know. I mean, I've only played, you know, a few games with four people. It was fun, but we're all kind of doing our own thing. And it felt a little bit disjointed to me. I still like the game, but I'm more apt to play it by myself than in a big group. There's other games that play cooperatively much better. Again, I will play this. I'll just play it in a solitaire mode. That's the Chief. See you guys later. Bye.
Thanks for watching our review today. For more information about board games, as well as the number one board game audio podcast, check out Dicetower.com for reviews, interviews, and more. I'm Eric Summerer, and you've been watching The Dice Tower.